I'm Aditya Nimbalkar. For over a century now, the process of filmmaking has been constantly evolving. The influence of technology has enabled filmmakers to provide good quality entertainment to the audience. In the past 10 years alone, digital technologies have enabled filmmakers to create visual effects which were earlier too expensive, too dangerous, or just impossible to create. Well, since the late 80s, non-linear editing systems have replaced cutting on film. These editing systems are so inexpensive that almost anyone can have one now. These systems also make the process of film editing much more simpler. So, let us see what is digital intermediate.
DI is it stands for digital intermediate. What it does, what it is actually, it's only a process. It's not really like an art form or something. It is the process, the intermediate process between the time the film is cut and ready to the time the negative is finally made. That intermediate process, which was normally done optically, is now done digitally. We need DI because some films have a lot of computer graphics, have a lot of visual effects, which in any case have to be done digitally. So they have to be done on a computer and created by a computer. Whereas the normal negative, the original negative, and the computer graphic negative have to be mixed together. Okay. If you have a film with a lot of graphics and a lot of visual effects, then it makes sense to do the whole film digitally. And because you can even out the difference between what is not real, computer generated, and what is real, a real negative.
To explain this slightly better, DI is the process of taking an edited film in the form of an EDL or cut list, taking the OK shots and scanning them at a very high resolution and working at them one by one. Even fixing the colors to make the film look interesting and doing effects or blending CG with normal footage. And finally making out a negative from which the producer can make multiple prints to show in the theaters. This negative which comes out is an intermediate and it is done digitally. Therefore the process is called digital intermediate. Telecine is converting film into video, whereas reverse telecine is converting video into film. Video, we consider it as PAL resolution. So even when reverse telecine occurs, it is also done in PAL resolution. So what happened before DI? I mean, films were made over a century ago. Did Charlie Chaplin or Hitchcock or Satyajit Ray ever use DI? And does the process of DI make a film better? Before DI, traditionally, films were shot and edited as they always have been, and they were color graded on a grading table shot by shot.
Traditionally, when a film is edited and completed, it is taken to a lab where there's a special machine called an analyzer, where you see the film on a shot by shot basis and you adjust colors on a shot by shot basis, try and match them, even them out. And that's how grading is done traditionally. It's what is called optical grading.
To tell you about the process of DI in simple and brief terms, I will first start about production. A film is shot and processed in the lab. After these rolls are processed, the film is converted into video through the process of telecine. The telecine machine reads the key code on the side of the film. Then it makes a table of key code versus time code. These telecine video rushes are then captured into an Avid film composer or a Final Cut Pro machine. These are editing systems. The sound is also similarly recorded with the help of Nagra spools, DAT tapes or hard disk recorders. In these film editing systems, the sound and picture is cut together in a creative way to form the story. You can say the film is being directed for the second time. Many films have effects of some kind, from simple dissolves and wipes to complex composites of live action and computer-generated images, CGI, what is commonly referred to as opticals. Putting together a film negative with a computer-generated image is a difficult task. Both are completely different mediums and respond to manipulation differently. Fortunately, if one finishes the film as a DI, then the entire film exists digitally. integrating digital negative with digital images is a relatively manageable task. The DI facility needs to create a digital negative to grade or to create a look for the film. The digital negative consists of files in a hard disk, each file for each frame. So for every 3 hour film, there can be as many as 2 lakh frames. Each scanned frame is in the format called .dpx or digital picture exchange. This format stores data in a manner which makes the grading system read it very rapidly. Remember, DI systems have to open and close 24 files each second. The DPX format stores not only the picture but also the timecode and the key code of the frame. It is this very property of the DPX format which makes the DI process possible. Okay, enough on DPX now. Now how does the original camera negative get converted into a DPX sequence or a digital negative? To convert the actual movie film into a digital negative, one needs to scan the negative. This is done through a scanner. So the second step in the process of DI is called scanning. The scanner is a rather large device which can run up to 2000 feet rolls. Light it up with a precisely calibrated light and converts each frame into a digital picture with up to 16-bit sampling depth. In short, basically what it does is it converts individual pixels into digital pixels. Think of it as 16 stops, and it does this for all three primary colors, red, blue and green. So it can resolve billions of colors. In effect, what you get is a digital negative which is very faithful to your original negative.
Can you tell us a bit about the scanning machine, the potential of the scanning machine, what's the speed of the scanning and how does it
the scanning machine
the time code with the timeline of the habit?
See, the scanning is a very plus point since it's basically a film scanner, what you say. It's like Imagica. Get exact details and exact densities, whatever you have shot on a camera negative from a camera negative. And you can go till, as per your job requirement, you can go till 2K, you can go till 4K, 8K and 10K also. It depends on what your job really needs of. And obviously it gives a more flexibility for the colorist to play along, since you have got densities, correct densities, you know, proper range where you can play on colors.
And the speed of the scanning is?
The speed of the scanning, it is 1.3 seconds per frame on a 2K. So, because usually 4K has not been very much in demand, except for few compositing shots if it need be, where you need to have intense compositing, so then you scan it on 4K, but anyways your projections are of 2K resolution only, so 4K is not supported, so it's better to have a 2K pipeline.
This process will actually enhance the look of your film and will be worth the money you're spending on the film. And to help this belief, I strongly recommend you cut a piece of your negative, go to the DI place you're considering, tell them to run it through their machines, and then take out a print and a negative and watch it in the theater. You'll be most amazed at the results. Another angle to scanning is log and lin, short for logarithmic and linear. Almost all scans nowadays are log scan. Although the scanner images the negative in a linear way, it converts and stores it as a log. Scanning takes place at 16 bit per pixel. To give you a sense of this, video takes place at 10 bits. Smoke, Final Cut Pro, Flames or even DigiBeta all happens in 10 bit. DVDs or Beta happens in 8 bit. Since film has much more latitude, scanning is done at 16 bits. 16-bit data creates very large images. Grading systems on most computers cannot process 16-bit data in real time, which is why they are converted into logs. DI mostly happens at 10-bit log, which is equivalent to 14-bit or 16-bit linear.
And the entire footage which you have scanned and before it goes to recorder, do you sort of store them in your workstations?
Can you tell us something
about those workstations?
See, there is basically the central storage device which is there, which is used for, you know, it's in approximately 10 TB, which is there, which is used for scanning data to be stored. Now basically it is like a long pipeline which is there, which it's very difficult if I need to explain, but we have got our main master station which is there where we do our primary and secondary color correction. It has got its own storage device, and also we you know, whenever it comes to the output, we need to see according to the availability of space, and we need to put that thing.
Once people start believing in the process of DI, the second thing which is hotly discussed is whether 2K or 4K. First, let's find out what these numbers mean. The scanner that scans the negative images it into a digital picture or a DPX file. This happens at a resolution of 2K or a higher resolution of 4K. Thus, 2K and 4K are resolutions. For your information, the negative is completely unharmed in this process, as the lamp used in scanning is too weak, unlike a projector lamp. Some scanners even use LEDs. 2K means each 35mm frame is equal to 2048 pixels wide and 1556 pixels tall. This is equal to 3 million pixels per frame. 4K means 4096 pixels wide and 3112 pixels tall. This means that 12 million pixels per frame. The scanner takes the negative in DPX format. Each DPX file for one frame. Each file is 12 MB in 2K resolution. And these files are stored in a hard disk. Each such frame contains timecode and keycode, and they're all organized into folders. If scanned at 4K resolution, the files are 50 MB per frame. Scanners are typically slow. Some scan at 2 seconds per frame, and some scan at 2 frames per second. The speed of scanning does not affect the synchronization of sound. The scanner scans each and every frame of the film. All you have to do is run them at proper speed to sync the sound. So far, no Indian or Hindi film has been made on 4K. Even in Hollywood, Spider-Man was one of the very few films made on 4K. While 4K is better than 2K, the 4K process is too challenging for systems to do reasonably. With file sizes being larger, systems work slower when working at 4K, almost a quarter as slow. So, if a 2K DI will take 1 month, you can be sure that a 4K DI will take 3 to 4 months. Besides, if one was not doing a DI on this film, then the original negative would be confirmed and then printed optically. Then, dupes of the original negative are made. It is widely believed that the final print does not exceed the resolution of 1K. So, the bottom line is, 2K is enough for the moment. Digital intermediate also does both these processes, but works at a much higher resolution, at least 2K. Let's assume the resolution of film is 2K. In a conventional telecine process, one frame on 35mm film, which is 2048 by 1556 pixels, is converted to 720 into 576 pixels, about 1/8 the size, and put onto a tape. If later this picture is reverse telecined from tape to film, you have a situation where a small 720 by 576 picture is blown up to 2048 by 1556, 8 times the size. When doing DI, the film is scanned at 2048 by 1556 pixels into digital file. One file for each frame. After that point, all the systems in the DI chain work on these files, but they leave them at 2048 by 1556. Finally, after all the action is over, the recorder also takes these 2048 by 1556 files and records them out to film. After all the shots are scanned, they lay on a large hard disk. Then these shots are conformed with the help of a conforming system. This conforming system is a computer which can read an EDL, and it also takes the necessary shots and can line them up on a timeline, just like doing a normal online edit.
Okay, after the negative has been scanned, the total edited length has been scanned.
Yeah.
What is, before it comes to the film recorder, what is the procedure involved within after that?
It's basically, once you have the scanning thing done, we need to confirm the things as per your offline. So that's basically, that involves your effects and all the things, whatever effects you have tried to give it on the offline or what you have thought about. So that's basically, once you start matching the complete thing, then all the effects and everything are done. If there is any wire removal or if there is any chroma shots, that's basically, if you need to make some graphics done, so that can be also be managed. And also, after the complete things are done with the effects, then you can surely proceed for grading.
After confirm, you have your whole film from start to finish on your timeline in full film resolution, that is 2K. All through the grading process, it is necessary to ensure that your digital negative is in sync with your original edit. The confirm machine confirms this side by side. The confirm timeline is opened on a grading system. Sometimes the confirm system itself does the grading. Either way, on a grading system, it is possible to adjust colors on a shot by shot basis. It is also possible to adjust just one color in one part of an image. You can give a scene or a shot a completely different feel than what was originally shot. Or to enhance the feel a cinematographer brings out with the help of lighting. If editing is the second time a film can be directed, grading is the second time a film can be filmed.
Luster is a product made by a company called Autodesk, which also makes products like Flame, Smoke, Inferno, Fire. Luster is their color grading tool. So it is primarily a color grading tool. It can do very little else than color grading. It can't do any compositing. It cannot superimpose shots on each other. It can do very, very little other than grading.
Can you tell us the difference between the smoke and inferno and fire?
Smoke, on the other hand, is a high-end editing and finishing solution. So it can do practically everything that an editing system can do. It can do layers, it can do keys, it can do tracking, it can do lots of things that Luster cannot do. But they are two separate products, and they do have some common features, but they have not too much in common. So you would use smoke to do things which require to composite shots together, which you would not do in a Luster, and vice versa, you would really not do film grading on a smoke, although you could, but you wouldn't do that.
See, Inferno is used for film compositing. It's a basically a compositing machine where it's a hardcore compositing where you do, where you go on multi-layerings and all the things where you need to, you know, like do wire removals, compositing shots like the chroma shots you people shoot on blue or green background. There you usually use Inferno mostly. Fire is another one. There is, you know, these are the software which have got a little bit different tools in some ways, which are basically meant as per the service providers. Every system is now again 64-bit. It's not the issue that previously it was not what do you call it, is a 16-bit application, it's a 32-bit application, but now all are what you see is 64-bit applications. And it depends what type of work you're looking at. If you're looking at compositing, you surely have got an option of Inferno and also Fire. And for confirming, surely you have got Smoke, and also the other version of Smoke can be used for HD.
Sure. Before the color correction, after your EDL is done on your offline systems, now before you bring them on to scan this negative, original negative, you have to go through the confirm through your smoke systems. Can you please explain me a little bit about that?
Yeah, see, what happens is once we get the complete EDL from the AVID or FCP, whatever the source is, we do scan the complete things with handles. That's basically in the head and tail, like with more handle frames, like 10 frames, 15 frames. So this, all the data which comes is a raw data. It's basically, it's not exactly with your length of the edit. So that we need to confirm with your offline dump what we get on the smoke. So there is basically this procedure: when we come to smoke, you take the offline reference, what has been edited on AVID, and according to that you pull your scans and try to match it as per the offline reference. And after the procedure is done, then we have to be export the complete timeline to Luster for carrying on the grading process.
In your Luster grading, color grading, what exactly you really mean when you're talking about the primary colors as well as the secondary colors?
See, primary, the grading consists of two particular things, to be very precise. It works on a RGB level, and it has got your primary and secondary color corrections. Now I'll explain you what exactly is primary. Primary means if you increase a red, in a frame, it will increase overall in the frame. But whereas if you need to have a separation of the background, or you need to, suppose there is a scene where you need to have mountains, you need to touch up the land, you need to touch up the sky, you need to touch up the mountains. So that basically works into secondary color correction. Now secondary color corrections is basically you try to separate from the frame and you try to give it a colors which you would like to. And that basically works on layers. So you can go on layerings and you can treat the complete frame altogether.
After you have gone through the process of entire luster, and before you come to the film recording, you're recording that entire footage.
Yeah.
Now there is confirming also is done.
We do confirm before it goes to recording with the AVID, so that there is no if there is a shot of duration or if there is a wrong shot which it usually doesn't happen, but sometimes we need to be very careful while we go for recording. But before recording, this thing needs to be confirmed, and after that the first thing what we look at as the dust cleaning, which is there on the you might be finding dust on your on your scans, so you need to clean up those, and then we proceed for recording.
Now let's talk about calibration and color management. While grading, one is looking at the picture on a display, a monitor or a projector. It's a digital representation of the original negative, a digital negative. What is needed is a system that ensures that the picture that one sees on the display is exactly what is printed on the negative. This is the color management system, or CMS. Calibration ensures that the display shows the same picture through the course of its life. After all the conform magic and the grading magic, the film finally has to go on 35mm, and so that you and I can go and watch these films in a theater, film recorders take digital negatives and record it back on a 35mm film. Different technologies are used for this: lasers, LCDs, CRTs. But one common thing is there between all these technologies, that these recorders are very slow.
Film recorder, whatever we do on a digital format needs to go back to film. So we have got film recorders, we have got two film recorders, and the calibration is done as per the most of the labs which are available. So there is no issue on the calibration also. So whatever we have is like we do calibrate as per the labs, wherever the client has his accounts and all, means where he wants to process the negative and all the things. And the speed and the advanced technology what we have is the CRT technology, which basically is very as per the sharpness, as per the as per the final results, it's like really awesome. It's always the person who is there on the negative manipulation, so you need to be very much with your experience and all the things. We need to satisfy the client basically.
And the recording's speed of the...
The recording speed is approximately 2.3 seconds per frame for a 2K.
On an average, the Indian film industry produces around 300 Hindi films per year, out of which only 30 to 40 go through the process of DI. As I said before, we are still heavily dependent on the traditional process of editing. Can DI surpass this in the near future?
I guess the DI itself is not likely to change the format of filmmaking unless the entire process of filmmaking can become digital. That is, if filmmakers choose to shoot digitally, they can shoot on HD cameras, they can shoot on cameras that can shoot 2K and even 4K. If the actual shooting is done digitally, and then obviously then the only way to do it is DI. So that part of it can become digital. The shooting part of it is still not digital, it's still film. And the other part is the projection part. We still have conventional theatres which show conventional film. So when theatres become digital and film shooting become digital, then of course the whole thing becomes digital. But that is still some distance away.
So, we just went through a roller coaster ride through the world of digital intermediate. DI is a process in between the acquisition of the film and the final distribution of a film. So in a way we can call it the digital master. Now hopefully we will be able to see a lot more of this digital master in the future.